हेलो एवरीवन, वेलकम टू आवर चैनल डेली डॉक्टर। दिस इज़ द सेकेंड वीडियो ऑफ टिटैनस। इन आवर प्रीवियस वीडियो वी हैव डिस्कस्ड अबाउट द इंट्रोडक्शन पार्ट ऑफ द क्लॉस्ट्रिडियम टिटैनी, इट्स पैथोजेनेसिस एंड ऑल्सो द मोड ऑफ ट्रांसमिशन। नाउ वी विल मूव ऑन टू द क्लिनिकल मैनिफेस्टेशंस, व्हाट एंड ऑल द साइंस एंड सिम्टम्स वी कैन सी इन दिस डिसीज दैट वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस इन दिस वीडियो टुडे। सो बिफोर मूविंग ऑन टू द actual clinical manifestations, let us recall what happens when during the pathogenesis. Once the toxin enters inside the motor nerve terminals, the toxin internalization will occur. It will reach the presynaptic inhibitory neuron terminals and prevent the release of what? It prevents the release of GABA and glycine. GABA and glycine neurotransmitters are inhibitory neurotransmitters. Once if they are released, what happens? Muscle relaxation will occur. But here in this condition, during tetanus, the exotoxin, tetanus toxin is going to inhibit the release of these inhibitory neurotransmitter. That is, it is completely preventing the relaxation of the muscles. That is why there is spastic muscle contraction. There is continuous, abnormal, prolonged muscle contraction, which is seen as a characteristic feature in this disease. Okay, now we will move on to the actual manifestations of the disease. So, what happens is, during the tetanus, in the initial first phase, once the disease has occurred, the infection has already occurred, during the first phase, what happens is, the facial muscles will get affected first. Facial muscles, why the facial muscles and the jaw first get affected is because of the shorter distance. It is due to the shorter distance for the toxin to reach the presynaptic terminals. The toxin can reach the face and jaw muscles easily because of the shorter distance. That is why the first features of this disease are seen as trismus and trismus or lockjaw. Trismus is nothing but a lockjaw. Lockjaw is a characteristic grinning appearance. That means increased masseter tone will be there, which leads to a rigid smile appearance. Masseter tone is increased during this disease, which leads to lockjaw. And followed by this trismus and lockjaw, there is muscle pain also there. There is stiffness of the muscles, back pain and difficulty in the swallowing can be seen during the initial stage of this disease. Once the disease starts progressing, what happens is, as the disease starts progressing, we can see painful muscle spasms, painful spastic muscle contractions for a prolonged period of time. It can be localized or it can be generalized. In around 80% of cases, it is generalized muscle spasm. In around 20% cases, it is localized means, for example, if the lower limb has got injured, the muscle spasm can be seen in that part only. That is called as localized muscle contraction. In generalized muscle spasm, what happens is, there is descending spastic paralysis. So what is this descending spastic paralysis? It is nothing but, first the facial muscles will get affected. First the proximal muscles, first facial muscles will get affected, which will produce lockjaw and rhesus sardonicus, nothing but a rigid smile appearance, then followed by the descending paralysis of the muscle. The upper limb and lower limb muscles will get paralyzed. This occurs during the progressive stage. Okay, now the disease has reached a severe condition. After 2 weeks of this disease, what happens is, tetanus reaches severe condition. Okay, it will produce severe autonomic nervous system disturbance. Once your ANS got affected, there can be symptoms associated with the disturbances due to your autonomic nervous system disturbances that can be fluctuation in the blood pressure. Your blood pressure may fall or it may rise even more. There can be tachycardia, there can be intestinal stasis, the bowel movements are reduced, sweating can also occur, that will be severe, that will be increased sweating, increased tracheal secretion can also be seen, and also there can be chances of occurrence of acute renal failure. This is the third phase, that is during the severe phase of the disease. One important point we have to focus here, although the person is having many of the symptoms here, there is a muscle ache, there is backache, difficulty in swallowing, he is having fluctuating blood pressures, he is sweating more, and all the things are there, but still he is unimpaired mentation. He is having unimpaired mentation. So what do you mean by this? Unimpaired mentation is nothing but his mental activity is not affected. His perfect mental activity is completely normal. And also hands and feet are spared. That means his hands and feet parts are not involved in this muscle spasm. They are protected. Once the disease has reached its last stage, we can see the complications. So the complications of the tetanus are specific and they are important to remember. So there are actually two terms. One is called as risus sardonicus. Second complication is called as opisthotonus position. So what is this risus sardonicus? Rhesus means something which is fixed, means which is rigid, and sardonicus in general means something which is humorous. That means person will appear like he is smiling, but there is actually spasm of his jaw muscles. There is a locked jaw, there is a rigid smile. He is not actually smiling, but appears to be producing grinning, okay. The actual definition of this rhesus sardonicus comes like this. There is an abnormal sustained spasm of facial muscles that appears to produce grinning. This is the first complication. And the second complication is associated with the generalized muscle spasm. It is an abnormal posture of the body. It is opisthotonus position is nothing but abnormal portion or abnormal posture of the body in which there is a spastic contraction, prolonged abnormal contraction of the extensor muscles. The person will be feeling very difficult during his movements also. He feel very much of pain during this condition. And the third complication will be paralysis of the respiratory muscles. Respiratory muscle spasm may occur, which will lead to difficulty in breathing. So this is all about the clinical manifestations of tetanus. Important terms which you are supposed to remember is trismus, nothing but lockjaw, and the complications are rhesus sardonicus, nothing but rigid smile, that is a person is appearing like he is producing grinning, and opisthotonus position where there is a spastic contraction of the extensor muscles. Now let us move on to the lab diagnosis. So how to identify that the injured person actually has got the tetanus? It is by the microbiological lab diagnosis method. First, we have to collect the specimen. So from where you are going to collect the specimen? Specimen is collected from the injured site itself. Injured site, from there you have to excise the tissue from the deep of the wound. You have to cut the small sample of the tissue from the wound, then you have to send it for the further investigations. Once that sample is taken or the specimen is taken, it is sent for the staining. All bacteria will be subjected for staining, either it may be Gram staining or Zn staining. For Clostridium tetani, it is the Gram staining. I've already told you, under the Gram staining, it produces characteristic drumstick appearance. Because Clostridium tetani is a gram-positive obligate anaerobic bacteria which produces terminal round spores like this, which appear purple in color. The round spores will be present in the diagram, and these will appear like these will be actually in the purplish color. But what happens is this Gram staining is not sufficient for Clostridium tetani, because there are other species such as Clostridium titanomorphon and Clostridium spinoids, which are also similar in appearance as that of Clostridium tetani. So you cannot rely only on the Gram staining. If you find this drumstick appearance, send it for further confirmation in the culture. Send this sample for culture, as this is a anaerobic obligate anaerobic bacteria. As Clostridium tetani is an anaerobic obligate anaerobic bacteria, so RCMB, that is Robertson cooked meat broth, is the preferred media for culture. It contains meat particles. If the specimen has got the Clostridium tetani, these meat particles are going to turn black and it will produce a foul smell. Black and foul odor, if you get that, that means it is confirmatory, that 100% it is confirmed that the given sample contains the Clostridium tetani. And one more culture is also there, that is called as blood agar with polymyxin B. These plates are actually incubated at 37 degrees Celsius for 20 to 48 hours in the anaerobic condition. In the anaerobic condition, if the given specimen contains this Clostridium tetani, what happens is there is a characteristic swarming growth. There is a characteristic swarming growth which we can appreciate in the plates. That means it is also confirmatory that the given sample has got Clostridium tetani. So this is all about the lab diagnosis. First, we have to collect the specimen from the injured site. Then we have to send it for Gram staining. Under the Gram staining, it is a Gram positive bacilli which has got drumstick appearance. In the culture, we have got RCMB and the blood agar with polymyxin B. Under the RCMB, it is the meat particles which are going to turn black and which produce foul odor. And in the blood agar, they produce a characteristic swarming growth. Now let us move on to the vaccines which are given prophylactically to prevent the occurrence of the tetanus. So vaccine can be available in the given forms, like it can be TT vaccine, that is nothing but tetanus toxoid, DPT, that is diphtheria pertussis whole cell preparation, and tetanus, and TT tetanus toxoid and adult diphtheria toxoid. So the vaccine is available in these three forms, also with pentavalent vaccine which contains DPT and hepatitis along with influenza B. Hepatitis B plus influenza B and DPT. So this vaccine is available in the tetanus vaccine is available in these all these forms. How the toxoid is actually prepared? You know, the tetanus, the Clostridium tetani produces two toxins, two exotoxin. One is tetanolysin and one is tetanospasmin. Tetanospasmin is the one which actually caused the disease. This tetanospasmin is treated with the formalin, then this toxoid is formed, then absorbed on the alum. This toxoid is formed, which is actually given in the form of वैक्सीन. सो वॉट आर द वैक्सीन्स विच शुड बी गिवन फॉर द चिल्ड्रन. सो टिटैनस इज एक्चुअली गिवन इन 7 डोजेस अकॉर्डिंग टू द नेशनल इम्यूनाइजेशन शेड्यूल ऑफ द इंडिया. टिटैनस शुड बी गिवन इन 7 डोजेस टू द चाइल्ड. 3 डोजेस एट 6, 10 एंड 14 वीक्स. आफ्टर दैट 2 बूस्टर डोजेस शुड बी गिवन इन द फॉर्म ऑफ DPT इन बिटवीन द 16th एंड 24 वीक्स एंड 5 ईयर्स. फॉलोड बाई 2 एडिशनल डोजेस ऑफ द अडल्ट डिप्थीरिया टॉक्सॉल शुड बी गिवन एंड एट 10 ईयर्स एंड 16 ईयर्स. If this immunization is missed in the adults, it can be given in the form of TD, that is tetanus toxoid plus adult diphtheria toxoid. So, what is the site where this vaccine is given? In case of children, it is the anterolateral aspect of the thigh, and in case of adult, it is the deltoid muscle, where it is given. The vaccine should be given deep intramuscularly, intramuscular route. This completes our video on tetanus. In our first part, we have explained about the morphology and pathogenesis. In the second video, we have explained about the clinical manifestations and lab diagnosis and vaccines which are given for tetanus. If you like these videos, please subscribe to our channel Daily Doctor. Thank you for watching.